A few years ago, I visited Dungeon Rock inside the woods of Lynn, Massachusetts. A deep cave said to be haunted and containing treasure left behind by a pirate dating back to the mid-1600s. I made a video about the complete story of the cave, which if you haven't seen, I suggest checking out first on the link down below. The skinny on it is basically that in 1852, a man named Hiram Marble purchased the land in hopes of finding a treasure said to be buried inside almost 200 years earlier. Although I'm happy with the original video overall, I really wish I showed the inside of the cave, and showed what it looks like to walk around inside. So I'm going to take another look at Dungeon Rock, and also the influence over its creation. The easy way to reach Dungeon Rock inside the Lynn Woods is to enter through the Pennybrook Road entrance. With over 2,200 acres of forest, this little tip will guarantee you the shortest route. The cave is open from 9 to 2:30 in the afternoon, Tuesday through Saturday. Hours can change depending on the weather and other conditions, so I would call the ranger ahead of time before you make the trip out. Along the way, you'll walk through some beautiful scenic paths until you reach the stone step walkway that leads you to the cave known as Dungeon Rock. Follow the steps to the top of the hill and you have arrived. Once at the peak, you'll notice the unique shape of Dungeon Rock, naturally formed by an earthquake that caused a piece of the rock to tip forward and permanently seal the cave opening. A flight of wooden steps lead you down into the bowels of pitch darkness. It's near impossible to try and navigate your way through the slick, wet surface of the cave without any lighting. If you're not careful, you could get seriously hurt. The last time I went inside, someone I was with slipped and dislocated his shoulder, which only served as a reminder to be extra cautious this time out, especially considering it rained earlier that morning. I came prepared this time with a headlantern and flashlight to see around in the cave, but even with the proper items, I was still unable to really record any video inside. So I did what I could. Pictures came out the best because of the flash, but unless you have a night vision camera, you're gonna have a tough time recording. My first task on this spelunking mission was the wooden steps, which were surprisingly sturdy and seemed like a fairly new restoration. The stairs proved to be extra slick from the rain earlier that day, but also provided some of the better pictures because you really get a perspective of how deep inside the ground you actually are. I could break Dungeon Rock down into three sections. The first, starting from the entrance, begins with the cave ceiling overhead in a huge opening. You're able to walk upright with no problem. But then it comes to a point where you have to step down to a lower part of the cave. This is definitely where the headgear and flashlight comes in handy. From here, the ceiling begins to get lower and lower before you're at the lowest point, fully bent over to continue forward. Which brings us to the second section of the cave. If you're claustrophobic, this part is going to bother you, and the darkness certainly doesn't help matters either. Even bent over, there's still not much room above you, so you might want to get down on your hands and knees at this point. After Hiram died, his son Edwin took over the digging. Looks like he started to dig a more narrower path, probably trying to get as far as he could. And finally, you'll reach the last section of the cave, which is the very bottom. Both times I made it down this far, I was greeted by a giant rock-filled pool of water. I'm not sure if it's possible to crawl down and continue on past this point. It looks like you might be able to continue forward, maybe if the water was drained. I like to think that you can find a way through and continue down a cave slide and drop down into a larger, more open area, like in the movie The Goonies. But it's probably just wishful thinking. This has always been as far as I've ever been able to make it. With all of his effort, Hiram Marble was only able to dig about a foot every 30 days. Even blasting away with the rock and with the help from his son Edwin, nothing could speed up the process. You can still find the pieces removed from the cave on the grounds of Dungeon Rock, and more down the adjacent hill. The twisting path of the cave is directly influenced by Marble's delusion that the spirits were leading him through the cave and right to the treasure. When you're inside, you can't help but find that amount of effort to be astonishing, especially considering that it's possible that there was never any treasure to be found. The official story of Dungeon Rock has always been that it was believed that Buccaneer Thomas Veal took the stolen hoard with him as he headed deeper and deeper into the woods. But no one really knows for sure. It wasn't until nearly two centuries later when the people of Lynn started blasting away at Dungeon Rock. By then, it was just an assumption on whether or not there was any fortune to be found. Dungeon Rock, it's such an oddity. It raises so many questions. Why would someone spend their entire life digging through a giant boulder? Especially someone who initially lived over 60 miles away. And what if he found the treasure and it wasn't even enough to cover the lifetime of digging expenses? Who would trust a ghost pirate anyway? The answer lies in spiritualism, which had its run from the 1840s to 1920s. Spiritualism is the belief that the ghost of the dead residing in the spirit world can communicate with the living, through the use of a medium most effectively during a seance. At its peak, it was said to have more than 8 million followers in Europe and the United States. Hiram Marble was one of the 8 million. He purchased the land inside of Lynn Woods in 1852, around the time spiritualism was really taken off. You see, just 4 years earlier, three sisters from New York were about to become the spark that would ignite the spiritualist movement. And it all started by one girl's cracking toe. Three sisters, Margaret, Kate, and Leah Fox, were some of the earliest proponents of spiritualism and some of the first well-known mediums from that era. The two younger girls had the powers, with the older sister, Leah, serving as the duo's manager. Their abilities were quite unique, because they were able to communicate with the spirits through a technique that would produce a sound that the sisters referred to as rappings. The girls would snap their fingers a certain amount of times, and the ghosts would respond with a similar sound, proving their communication. The Fox sisters would publicly demonstrate their abilities, holding seances, convincing spectators, and spreading spiritualism along the way. But were the girls actually communicating with the dead, or was it all just a hoax? The rappings were simply the result of perfect control over the muscles below the knee. The girls could produce certain noises from their knuckles and joints, and the same could be made with the toes. In 1888, despite their older sister, who they were feuding with, and for $1,500, Margaret Fox, with Kate present, demonstrated in front of 2,000 people the mysterious rappings actually came from her toe joints. Doctors were also on hand to verify the source of the sound. The girls would even denounce spiritualism, calling it an absolute falsehood from beginning to end. But by then, it was too late. Passionate followers of spiritualism had grown to over 8 million people. And how passionate were the spiritualist followers? Well, passionate enough to dig 200 feet into solid rock, wasting an entire lifetime in physical labor with no payoff. Hiram Marble's belief was so strong that he not only wanted to find the treasure at Dungeon Rock, but hoped his efforts would prove the validity of spiritualism. Obviously, the confession of the Fox sisters, who are often credited with starting spiritualism, did nothing to deter the efforts of Hiram Marble from digging away for the rest of his life. And that's really what Dungeon Rock is. It's someone's life. The Marbles built a home for themselves on the property, as well as other structures, which to this day you can still find remnants of on the land. Another thing you can see while touring the grounds is this stone, which marks the grave of Edwin Marble, the son of Hiram, the last one to dig for treasure never found at Dungeon Rock. The Pink Rock, as it's called, is over by an old cellar hole at the top of a set of stairs. The last thing I want to talk about is the cave's reputation as a haunted location. After all, it was the ghost of Thomas Veal that was said to be communicating with Hiram Marble, leading him further and further down the cave, starting the ghostly history dating back to the mid-1800s. But even before Hiram Marble purchased the land, there were multiple attempts to blast away the rock to uncover the pirate's hoard left behind. Not to mention various visits from different so-called spiritualist mediums, attempting to contact the spirits of the pirates, all which turned up nothing. A common claim is that the ghost of both Hiram Marble and Thomas Veal haunt Dungeon Rock and the surrounding forest inside Lynn Woods. Today, visitors still come to step inside the creepy cave and walk around like I did. Gone are the spiritualists from the 1800s, but now in their place are the modern-day paranormal explorers. Now, I've been to Dungeon Rock many times, but I've never had a paranormal experience there or anywhere for that matter. The closest thing I can point to inside the cave would be these orbs that appeared in a lot of my photos. Paranormalists would call them spirit orbs, and they are thought by some to be the ghosts in form of balls of light. So are the orbs in my pictures proof of ghosts at Dungeon Rock? Or are they just flim-flam, like the cracking toes of the Fox sisters? orbs are generally captured at night and even underwater. If there's another source of bright light near your camera, it can also cause one to appear in one of your pictures. It's most common with smaller or more compact digital cameras that the average person takes pictures with. The lens and built-in flash are closer together, creating a light angle that picks up out-of-focus dust or water droplets. Light is reflected off the dust, or in this case a water drop, back into the camera lens, causing it to be illuminated and caught on film. A cave is the perfect environment for this. Having rained earlier in the day and because of the type of camera I used, the conditions were exactly right. Even in the paranormal world, orbs have been recently discredited, often chalked up to dust or just water droplets. So should you visit Dungeon Rock? I say absolutely. It's a marvel to look at, it's easy to get to, and it's free. Even back in the day when Hiram Marble lived here, there was a fee to tour the cave. But Hiram had no choice but to charge something because he blew through all his savings within 4 years of owning Dungeon Rock. So let's not let his efforts go in vain. Today it won't cost you a penny to take a look around inside, so why wouldn't you? When you step into Dungeon Rock, you're not just entering a cave. You're also entering the delusion of one man's quest to prove what just might be unprovable.